You may have an image in your head of how life came to be on Earth. A bubbling primordial soup in which life forms evolved over millions of years and eventually crawled from the oceans onto the land. But new research suggests that instead, it might have been the other way around. We've had the idea that life began in the oceans since the 1920s when it was first put forward. This was then cemented in our minds in the 1950s by the classic Miller-Urey experiment, from which scientists hypothesized that the ocean atmospheric cycle of early Earth could have been the perfect conditions to instigate life. But there were still lots of unanswered questions. And since then, biogenesis researchers, those are the folks who study how life began, have been kind of obsessed with finding that key catalyst that would have brought chemical components together for the very first time. And researchers from the past several years have shown that in some situations, that special sauce could have been UV radiation. And while some teams have been able to recreate the building blocks of life using UV light, no one has yet been able to successfully perform these transformations in experiments that replicate seawater, meaning that our whole life crawls onto land from the oceans idea could be wrong. And here's another problem. While water is a definite requirement for life on Earth, the chemical properties of straight-up H2O actually break down proteins, including things that are made of protein, nucleic acids like DNA and RNA, that genetic material that holds the blueprint for all of life. Now, these days, living cells tightly control their water balance to protect their insides from water degradation, but how are proteins supposed to have formed in a substance that actively attacks and degrades them? Scientists now call this the water paradox. And in 2009, we start to get some answers. John Sutherland and his team at Cambridge performed a series of experiments that successfully produced two of the four nucleotides that make up RNA, using just a really simple starting mix of basic chemicals that may have been found on early Earth. They exposed this mixture to UV radiation and presto chango, nucleotides. Now, key in these experiments is that these chemicals were all dissolved in water, but at very high concentrations. That means lots of the chemicals to just a little bit of water, like really strong Kool-Aid. And this indicates that even though water may have been involved at the beginning of life, it couldn't have been in a giant body of water like an ocean, where the concentration of those chemicals wouldn't be as strong. For the chemicals to be in high enough concentrations and to be exposed to sunlight for that crucial UV component, some scientists believe that this life-giving reaction had to have occurred in environments like small pools. And next, building on the work that produced the nucleotides, in 2015, Sutherland and his team were also able to produce the building blocks of proteins and fats. And that's a big step because now with nucleotides and protein and fat precursors, we've got all the moving parts needed to get life going. And in 2020, other teams have found even further answers to the water paradox. Researchers created conditions where almost proteins could form and survive during wet-dry cycling, which is exactly what it sounds like. The molecules are allowed to dry out for some time before they're exposed to water again. And the researchers discovered this process is selective. Only the molecules we would expect to see on an early Earth withstood this cycling and were actually shaped by it. This wet-dry cycling has even shown to essentially select for more complex combinations of nucleic acids inside little protective lipid bubbles that help those nucleic acids make it through dry periods. And scientists think this may be a precursor to something like a cell. And all of this lends even more support to the idea that the body of water from which life may have sprung would have to be shallow and prone to drying out from time to time. Imagine all of life being descended from some stuff growing in a puddle. It's also worth mentioning here that not everyone is in agreement on this. Although there are commonly agreed on necessary original ingredients, some teams are still looking into deep sea vents as a possibility for the birthplace of life, while others think hot springs are a likely contender. And why is any of this important anyway? Aside from answering existential questions about where the heck we come from, a better idea of how life originated here on Earth gives us clues about what it might look like or where to look for it on other planets too. For example, in February of 2021, the Perseverance rover successfully landed in Mars's Jezero crater, which seems to have once been an ancient lake. And given all of this research, the crater is now a prime suspect for signs of life on the red planet. Now, it'll be years before the samples return to Earth, but maybe, just maybe, they'll contain remnants of those proteins or lipids that would tell us if we aren't the only planet that's ever hosted life. Check out this video for more on what early life on Earth might have been like, and if you have questions about this origin of life scenario, let us know down in the comments below. Let us know too if you have another experiment you want us to cover, and make sure you subscribe to Seeker for more on ideas about life on other planets. As always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.